Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you have had a good day so far. Thank you again, Esmandiar, for your fabulous lecture. I'm happy to introduce our guest speaker, Professor Viktor Chernozhukov. Viktor is a distinguished econometrician and mathematician from MIT. He has also been author and co-author of many papers published in top journals. And without further ado, we are all very pleased to have you here today. Please give him a warm welcome while he's coming to the stage.
Thank you very much for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to be here. My lecture today will consist of two parts. One part will be about linear models, and the second part would become more nonlinear and maybe more complicated than the first part. Let me start with the linear models. So it's called the causal inference and high-dimensional approximately sparse structural linear models. So there have been recently two major developments that force us to consider more and more elaborate econometric models than before. The development number one was the availability of rich data, new rich data. It's called big data, for the lack of a better word. And another development has been methodological, and this methodological development was partly in response to the availability of this rich data. So to make things concrete, I'll focus the discussion on the following structural linear equation model. So we have here a structural equation. So there's a functional relation plus a noise. Here we have the outcome variable. Di here is going to be the treatment variable or variable of interest whose effect on the outcome we would like to learn. We have a set of controls. The controls are going to be high dimensional. Potentially, the dimension p here could be larger than the sample size. So this is what we have, what we mean by rich data. The xi's here are high dimensional. There is a noise component. And the noise component is orthogonal to the exogenous variables. These exogenous variables include the controls themselves, as well as the instrumental variable zi. So epsilon I is uncorrelated with zi's. Zi's could be affecting the treatment, but they don't directly enter this equation. Okay, so this is an instrumental variable model from econometrics here. I mean, there are various names for this model, like a linear structural equation, linear endogenous model. It does cover the regression, the conventional regression model, as a special case, right? Because if you have zi equal to di here, this would be just become a regression, just a standard regression model. So this is slightly more general because this this allows a different conditioning variable here, makes it slightly more general. And right. So there are two reasons for having lots of controls here. One reason is that if you look at several modern data sets, for example, U.S. Census data. You see that there are many characteristics, recorded characteristics available to do the analysis. If you look at house appraisal analysis or house pricing analysis, there are lots of housing characteristics available that you could use. In the example that I'll talk about, there are lots of geographical controls that you could use. If you look at text data, there are lots of text features you could use in the analysis. And this is this is all called rich data or big data. So this is one aspect of big data. Another aspect is just simply massive data sets. that's another characteristics of big data. So we'll mainly focus on the rich data aspect of the big data. So this is one reason for having high dimensional controls here. Another reason for having high dimensional controls here is that along with the so-called raw controls, we could have transformations of the raw controls here. So for example, we could have polynomial transformations of controls and interactions of these raw controls in an effort to make the models more flexible. And this is, this type of modeling emerged like in two waves. The first wave was in the 80s, and it was called series or sieve estimation, right? It's a previous generation of the techniques. It's basically, you create these transformations of raw controls in an effort to have better approximations to the regression functions. And the new wave of this non-parametric or flexible fitting techniques is called quote-unquote machine learning. Even I personally don't like the name machine learning, but because everybody uses this name, I'll use this name as well, like machine learning. So there could be lots of controls here, right? Another question we could ask here is like, what's the reason for having many controls here? Well, what's the reason for having controls at all here in this equation? Well, there are two reasons. One is identification. For example, this effect of interest could only be identified as causal if the variation of this variable here is exogenous given the control. So we need the controls for identification of the effect, right? So this is called controlling for confounders, like in statistics. Another reason for having controls here is a noise reduction. Maybe they're not needed for identification of the causal effects, but if we don't have controls over here, we would have all of this part as part of the variance, like contributing to estimation noise, and By controlling for stuff, we are able to reduce the amount of noise in the system and get more precise estimates of the effects. Right. So whatever reason for having controls here and having many controls here, we are forced to confront the issues of model selection. So once we have lots of controls, and we will see empirical examples where we have lots of controls, we're forced to do model selection. Right. And we would need to select controls that are most relevant here. And there are two sets of model selection techniques. One could use the classical model selection techniques based on testing, simple testing. For example, you could use TNF tests in when the number of controls is not too large. Like if in moderately high dimensional problems where P is not so large compared to the sample size, you could rely on the usual TNF tests to do model selection, to do model reduction, or you could in the modern settings where the number of controls is larger than the sample size, you cannot use the classical techniques. You have to rely on the modern techniques. I'll be mostly mentioning this technique called Lasso. You've seen several introductions to Lasso already. In short, it's a model selection device where you penalize the size of the model through by the sum of the absolute values of the coefficients. Okay, and I will introduce it more formally later. I don't need to introduce it now. And I'll in the second part of my talk, I'll be mentioning like regression trees, random forest, boosting, things like this. These are other machine learning techniques. You could look at them as model selection techniques or regularization techniques more generally. So in the first part of the talk, I'll be mostly focusing on T tests and Lasso tests, like T tests in low dimensional settings, Lasso in high dimensional settings. You'll see that Lasso in low dimensional settings very much acts like a T test. The short story: we are forced to do model selection here, but we have to be super careful about how we do this model selection. So if we apply these model selection techniques directly in this equation one, so even take the exogenous version of this model, where Zi is equal to Di, so this is just a regression model. If you simply dropping variables here based on t-test or lasso, like lasso selection techniques, it's basically it's a wrong way to do it. It's a wrong way to do it, and I'll show you why. And so that's kind of a negative message, but there will also be a positive message. There is actually a good way to do it. And to do it correctly, we have to do additional selection. And this additional selection, we'll call it double selection, will work correctly. Okay. So there's a good way to do model reduction in this high dimensional settings under some mild assumptions. So here's a concrete empirical example. This example is due to originally due to Akimoglu, Johnson, and Robinson, 2001, American Economic Review. So they tried to study the effect of institutions on the wealth of nations. In particular, they looked at the data set, which consisted of 67 observations on former European colonies. So they recorded the outcome variable was log GDP, generalized domestic product per capita, today in the country I. There are 67 countries. DI was the quality of institution, a measure of quality of institutions. In their case, it was the degree of protection from expropriation of private property. Alpha was the effect that they wanted to estimate, the causal effect that they wanted to estimate. They considered some geographical controls here, and there was an error term here. The wealth of a country and the quality of institutions are probably jointly determined, right? So because well, the wealth affects the quality of institutions affects the wealth. So there's obvious endogeneity problem. So we need an instrument, the instrument that forces fluctuations in the quality of institutions, but doesn't directly affect the GDP. In other words, we need an instrument that affects the quality of that affects the GDP only through the quality of institutions. And they argued in their paper as well as the book, like they have a book devoted to the subject, that the instrument which measured the early European settler mortality 200 years ago is a good instrument because it affected the quality of institutions, but doesn't directly affect GDP, GDP per capita today once you control for geography. Okay, because, well, the health technology today is very different from the health technology 200 years ago. There's no direct link. So what was the reasoning? The rough story is as follows. They argued that in the areas where the European colonizers wanted to stay for a long time and plan to live there, like say United States, they established high quality institutions. In the areas where they had they experienced high mortality, they didn't plan to stay for long, and then they set up just extractive, poor quality institutions, just like wanting to grab resources and just get out from a country, right? And so they then ended up establishing poor institutions. Like for I guess an example would be India. They set up poor quality institutions in those countries, and the institutions are very persistent over time. So whatever happened to 200 years ago still has an effect today, but doesn't have a direct effect on the wealth once we control for geography. Okay. So that was their argument, and so they proceeded to analyze this empirically using very simple specifications. So they considered very simple specifications here. So one of the specifications was to just control for a constant here as well as the latitude. They also considered simple specification where they had continent dummies, right, or continent indicators. What I'll do, I will consider two specifications. I will consider one of their baseline specifications, and I'll also consider a more flexible specification where I include the basic controls, and I just add the cubic spline in latitude with several knots. I add the continent indicators or dummies, and this gives me 16 controls, right? 16 controls, It's not larger than the sample size, but the 16 is a pretty serious quantity compared to the sample size here, right? So this model is a lot more flexible than the basic model, and here are the results that I get. So this is the basic specification. In the basic specification, the institution effect is very strong economically, and it also statistically it's highly significant. So the standard error 0.21. It's significant at 1% level and so on. I mean, if we do flexible controls, well, the point estimate is about the same, but naturally the standard error gets inflated. The estimated effect is not very precise. So the result disappears. Of course, I could do something like this on every empirical paper. I could say, I'm just going to write down a much more flexible model, and the result is going to disappear. And so the question is, can we somehow do the model reduction here, like careful model reduction, and still say something useful about this empirical example? So one common practice that people do, either explicitly or implicitly, is to just simply ignore this line. They say, well, I did my robustness check. I ran this second set of results. The point estimate is about the same. The standard errors the results are not significant, but I cannot statistically distinguish these two point estimates. And then I just erase this line and I only report this line. Some people say this explicitly. It's called Hausmann test, right? Like you compare two estimates, you go for the more efficient one. And some people do it implicitly. They say, I'm going to do this. I'm going to report both of these estimates. I'll report this in the main paper, and I'll report this in the appendix, online appendix. Right? That's kind of anyhow, either way, there is a model selection going on, and people tend to erase this line and just report this line. And I'm going to argue that this is a potentially dangerous empirical practice, and it could, in fact, be very dangerous and very misleading. It's not a good way to do model selection. Okay. So how can I prove this? Well, I'll prove this by considering a very simple model. So forget about high-dimensional framework. Just focus on the case where P, the number of controls, is 1. And we're just considering whether to include this control or not. Okay, and we have the exogenous model. So this is just a simple regression model. We have the outcome, we have the treatment variable, we have one control plus error. The error is orthogonal to the treatment and the control. And there's a common practice is the procedure that I'll call the post-single selection procedure. In step one, we include Xi only if it happens to be a significant predictor of Yi as judged by a conservative pretest, such as t-test in a low-dimensional setting. So here, definitely in the low-dimensional settings, I could use t-test to do model selection. Or in the high-dimensional settings, I could use lasso. I mean, of course, I could use lasso in the low-dimensional settings as well. It will just act like a t-test, in fact. We'll see it numerically. And I'll drop this Xi otherwise. So if a t-test tells me, this is a significant predictor of outcome, I'll keep it. Otherwise, I'll drop it. In step two, refit the model after selection. Use standard confidence intervals for inference. Right. So this is a standard procedure that people use in empirical practice. There are probably thousands of theoretical statistical papers written justifying this procedure. And the justification goes like this. So you just assume that beta is either 0 or it's very large, so that a statistical test can detect that it's different from 0. And then with probability going to 1, you make no model selection errors. So you have perfect model selection with probability close to 1. Because, if beta is very large, your test, such as t-test or lasso, will figure this out and will correctly tell you should be keeping this Xi. If it's 0, you will drop it, right? And so in these two regimes, the procedure will work perfectly, but it will actually fail miserably, like in the middle ground. So if beta is not large and it's not 0, but it's close to 0, in the sense that it's you cannot tell it apart from zero by a statistical test, then the procedure can fail miserably, and I'll show you this in a computational experiment. So formally, this is captured in the asymptotics where beta is local to zero. Formally, it's beta is proportional to 1 over root n. Okay, so this is just an asymptotic approximation to the case where beta is close to zero in finite samples. So here's a Monte Carlo experiment of showing that this procedure fails. So here we have our equation. We also need to specify how the treatment and control are related. So here they're going to be correlated, as typically the case in observational studies. Gamma here is going to be 0.8. Beta here, the alpha, the effect of interest here is 0, so there's no effect. Beta here, the beta here is 0.2. Sample size is 100. So beta is not 0. Beta is different from 0, but it's small enough that it makes it difficult for a test to distinguish it from 0. So occasionally, the test will be making, a t-test will be making mistakes and telling us that beta is 0. In fact, it's not 0 here. Everything is normally distributed here. And we are running this procedure using a t-test here and look at the distribution of the post-model selection estimator, and we see that this is the actual finite sample distribution of the post-model selection estimator. It's not centered around the truth. It's centered around 1.5, something like this, and the shape of the distribution is not normal. The theory based on perfect model selection would tell you that, it should be centered around the truth and the shape of the distribution should be normal. But in fact, it's not the case. So if you end up using the perfect model selection theory, also sometimes called the oracle theory or oracle property for inference, that's actually a bad way to do inference here because you will be rejecting the truth of zero about 50% of the time in this computational experiment for the nominal 5% tests. Right? So you'll be finding the non-zero effect 50% of the time, even though the truth is actually zero. So you'll be finding significance where there is none, and it's simply because the model selection procedure is just not a good model. I mean, this is not a good way to do model selection here if the purpose is inference on alpha, okay? So this is so here we're doing this selection by a t-test. What if we use modern, quote-unquote, modern model selection techniques such as Lasso? Does it change? Maybe somehow it works better. Actually, it doesn't work better if we replace a t-test by Lasso here. Actually, in low-dimensional settings, Lasso would very much work like a t-test. And you see the results are not very different. Right? So definitely, Lasso is not a panacea against bad statistics, right? So it's just it's a tool, but I mean, the tool can be used incorrectly as well, right? So there's no it doesn't fix problems. So there's a problem, and the question is, what are the potential solutions? So there's a couple of pseudo-solutions. One solution, and it's actually not a bad idea, is to say, well, why don't we do bootstrap the model selection procedure? Because if we could approximate this distribution, right, it's not normal, but if we can approximate this distribution, maybe we can do incorrect inference. It turns out, actually, bootstrap will approximate this Gaussian curve instead of this red curve. It doesn't, for this reason, doesn't work. Okay, so bootstrap will not work. The classical solution is to just assume the problem away. You assume that either beta is zero or beta is bounded away from zero, so beta is much larger than zero, so that the statistical test can tell these two situations apart. And basically, this rules out the middle ground. So you say beta is so large that there is so much signal that you can detected, or it's just zero. There's no middle ground. Okay. I don't believe that this is a good solution. Okay. And then there's also conservative prescription, which says, well, just don't do selection. Selection is bad. Don't do selection. And naturally, it's a good suggestion in this Monte Carlo experiment. In this Monte Carlo experiment, it's a good suggestion. Like, don't do selection. Why would you want to do this? Because, well, if the number of controls is just one, there's no need to do model reduction here, maybe. But on the other hand, if we go back to our empirical example, well, here, don't do model selection is not a good suggestion. Because once we wrote down this model, we have to say that these are our empirical results. We cannot report these results. So what's the solution that we propose is to do this post double selection procedure, which has an additional round of model selection. It's going to be a lot more conservative than the previous procedure. So step one would be the same as before. We will include the control Xi if it happens to be a significant predictor of outcome as judged by a conservative pretest, t-test in low dimensional settings, maybe adjusted for multiplicity of testing, and lasso in high dimensional settings. In step two, we do additional round of selection. So here, even like we could be dropping Xi in this step. But in step two, we still have a potential of including Xi if it happens to be a significant predictor of the treatment variable as judged by a conservative pretest such as t-test or lasso in high dimensional settings. And so this is in the regression case, and in the IV instrumental variable models, in the instrumental regression models, we will also include Xi if it happens to be a significant predictor of the instrument. Okay, so in the instrumental regression, things are a bit more complicated. So still, we'll call this double model selection procedure, and then we will refit the model after selection. If it's a regression, it's going to be just the usual OLS. If it's a instrumental regression, it's going to be two-stage least squares, okay? And then we'll use standard confidence intervals for inference. And then here's an informal statement of result. So this double selection procedure turns out to be theoretically valid in low-dimensional settings as well as in high-dimensional approximately sparse settings. So we proved it this maybe 6 years ago. It got published in the Review of Economic Studies. So this I'll give a more formal version of this theorem later on, but right now it's just enough to say that it's theoretically valid, and it works in Monte Carlo, right? So it's one thing to say things are theoretically valid. It's good to check actually if they work numerically or not, right? So here's the same Monte Carlo experiment as we had before. We have our outcome equation. We have the equation that relates the treatment to the control. Exactly same specification as before. The difference is now, instead of doing single selection, we're doing double selection. We're being a lot more careful about dropping the Xi. We're testing whether both beta and gamma are close to zero. And we're definitely keeping Xi if either beta, if we think that beta or gamma are not different from zero. Okay. And so here's the distribution, the finite sample. So the blue histogram here is the finite sample distribution of the post double selection estimator. It's nicely centered around the truth of zero. And the shape of the distribution is approximately Gaussian. So this estimator is approximately Gaussian and approximately correctly centered around the truth. And if you end up testing the null hypothesis of zero here, which is the true hypothesis here, you would be rejecting this hypothesis at about the nominal nominal frequency. Okay.
What's the variance of the
Oh, it's you could deduce it from here, yeah. Right. So here we're doing double selection by doing t-test here and t-test here. If we replace this by lasso in these low dimensional settings, actually, there's no, if you took look at the two figures, the only difference is the title in the figure. So actually, for every Monte Carlo draw, they do exactly the same, like you get exactly same numerical results. So it kind of emphasizes the analogy between lasso and t-test in low dimensional settings. So this analogy will disappear in high dimensional settings, but right now it's not so much about lasso or t-test. So what's going on in this double selection? So why does it work? So it's an additional selection. It creates this robustness, basically. So we're trying to select controls that predict either the treatment or the outcome variable. And basically, the procedure tries to find controls whose emission would lead to large emitted variable biases, and it includes makes sure to include those controls in the final regression. Okay. And I'll explain this intuition in more detail. You can, if you know the free Schwab Lavelle partitioning out procedure for estimating linear regression, you could look at this procedure and say, oh, this is just a model selection version of the free Schwab Lavelle partitioning out procedure. Okay, so yeah, it is. So here's some intuition via omitted variable bias analysis. So we have this simple toy example as before. And then let's think about what happens if we drop this control. And if we drop this control, we end up running short, the so-called short regression of yi on di of the outcome on the treatment, omitting this xi. Then we can rewrite the estimator minus the target times root n as a sum of two terms. One term is going to be very well behaved. I'll call it good term. And there's going to be an omitted variable bias term, which will have this root n here. There will be two matrices, and there's going to be a product of gamma and beta here. Beta and gamma, right? So gamma here is responsible for confounding, right? Now, the good term will be asymptotically normal and very well behaved. So what we want is for this term to disappear. We want this term to disappear. And for this, we need root n times gamma times beta to be small. Okay. Now, the single selection procedure will drop xi only if beta is local to 0. If beta is large, it will keep the xi, no problem. Right? If beta is local to 0, it drops the xi. But this does not guarantee that the omitted variable bias is small, because if we look at the back of envelope calculations, like informal calculations quickly, we have root n times root n times gamma times beta. Beta, let's say beta is of size 1 over root n. Then this term does not go to 0 if gamma is bounded away from 0. So if there is confounding here, gamma is bounded away from 0, this term will not be small, and the omitted variable bias does not go to 0. So this term is responsible for this. Yeah, this bias does not, there's bias here, and this bias does not disappear. The double selection procedure is a lot more careful. It drops xi, it does drop xi, but it drops xi only if both beta and gamma are local to 0. Right, so it looks at whether beta and gamma are it does simultaneous testing of beta and gamma being close to 0, and it will drop xi only if both beta and gamma are local to 0. And if we do back of envelope calculations, we have this for the size of the emitted variable bias in the situation, we have root n times gamma times beta. So we only drop xi in double selection when this term is a 4 or 1 over root n. So because you have root n times divided by root n And so you have 1 over root n, and this term is small. So there will be occasionally, yes, there will be omitted variable bias here as well, but in the double selection procedure, but it's going to be small, and it will be vanishing here. So this is, and this is what you see here. There's probably some small bias here, but it's vanishing asymptotically. Okay, so this is quick intuition for why one procedure doesn't work and another procedure works. So let's go. Let's apply this double selection procedure in this Akimoglu-Johnson and Robinson example. There the Xijs are fairly high dimensional, so we use Lasso there. I'll introduce Lasso formally later. Right now, I just say we use Lasso as a model selection device. And we will include all Xijs, the geographical controls that happen to be significant predictors of either outcome, treatment, or the instrument. And it turns out that the only significant predictor of any of those three variables in this example is the indicator of Africa continent. All other, like once you control for Africa, other instruments are not so important. Oh, sorry, other controls are not so important. Right? So the only control that is important is the indicator of Africa. Okay. And so if we look at this result from the double selection manages to reduce the model, right? Reduce the model, gives us the point estimate of 0.78, which is in the ballpark of the original estimates, a bit lower, still in the ballpark of the original estimate, and this a slightly tighter standard error here. So there's a... So in summary, we had basic specification, we had flexible specification. Flexible specification was good. It was flexible, but was giving us very imprecise estimate. We said that it's not okay to just switch from this line to this line. We have to be careful. We have to do double selection. If we do double selection, we get a point estimate that is in the ballpark of the basic results with a standard error. So this our results here end up confirming what this study obtained. So we do agree with the this previous analysis. Okay. So let's look at before we go and do some theory, let's look at another empirical example. In this empirical example, we'll be looking at the effect of abortion on murder rates in the United States. This example is originally due to Donahue and Levitt. It's featured in their book called Freakonomics and also the movie called Freakonomics. And so, what's the background for this? In the 70s, there was a legalization of abortion in the United States. This legalization was introduced, it led. To dramatic changes in abortion rates in different parts of the United States. So as you know, there are 50 states within the United States, each of them experienced its own dynamics for the changing abortion rates. And Donahue and Levitt claim that this is primarily, these changes in abortion rates are responsible for the dramatic decline in the murder rates 20 years down the road. So they make this very strong claim. It's pretty clear that this strong claim, if you look at the book and also look at the movie, they do make this strong claim that the nothing else but the abortion led to the decline in the murder rates 20 years down the road. So let's look at this statistically. So here we have YIT is going to be change in crime rate, so murder rate in state I between time points t and t minus 1. So t stands for a year here. So it's a the yearly change in the murder rate in state I. DIT here is a change in the lagged abortion rate. So the roughly the lag is 19 or 20 years, something like this. And then we consider two specifications. One is going to be the basic specification, analogous to what they used. And another will be a flexible specification, which will be a bit more flexible. So let's look at the details. So in the basic specification, we will use some time-varying confounding state-level factors, such as presence of police force, generosity of welfare programs, prisoner population, things like this, right? Something that correlates with outcomes and the treatment variable here. In the flexible specification, we consider all of these basic controls. So there are about 20 of them. Oh, and by the way, trends, right? So we also have trends here. In the flexible specification, we have all of these basic controls. We also include state initial conditions for the abortion rates. And we do very simple technical transformations of these basic controls. We also include all the two-way interactions of all of these variables. So this means we will include the squares of these variables as well as the products of the variables. So this makes model slightly more flexible. If this is a linear model, this will be like a quadratic model with respect to the original specification. So we started with 20 controls here. We end up with 251 controls. And the sample size here is 576. So this is a fairly high dimensional specification if we compare the P to N. So P is not larger than N, but it's comparable to the sample size. So it's a fairly high dimensional specification here. Not surprisingly, if we go ahead and estimate this to specification, in the basic specification, we get this abortion effect of minus 0.20, so it's minus 20%. It's a very strong effect economically and also statistically, it's highly significant. So, if we look at the flexible specification results, well, given that there are 251 controls here and the sample size is this, not surprisingly, the standard errors are highly inflated and the results are not significant. Of course, if we look at this large model, we say, well, probably, I mean, this is what we would expect, right? Once you make the model flexible enough, the results go away, we should probably be thinking about the model reduction here. And there are two ways in which we can do model reduction. One would be the single selection procedure, which I described as a dangerous way to do model selection, and the double selection procedure, which is a more robust way to do a model selection. And if we apply these two procedures, we get the following result. So it turns out that the single selection procedure, the dangerous one, gives us point estimates that are very close to the baseline estimates, even with a tighter standard error. But the double selection procedure gives us, well, point estimates that are still in the ballpark, but the standard error is 0.21. So it does reduce the standard error from 1.1 to 0.21, but if you look at this point estimate and this standard error, you can conclude that you cannot reject the zero effect of abortion rates on the crime rates. You cannot reject this effect. Like this point estimate and as well as zero will be within the confidence band. So from this we conclude that actually there's not enough evidence in the data to conclude one way or another. Maybe there is a strong effect, maybe there isn't. Okay. So it's interesting, I mean, it's actually interesting to look at what the double selection is doing here. It does find a parsimonious model. It really chops down this gigantic model to an eight-dimensional model. So it just keeps like eight controls. But the important ones is that it selects state initial conditions as well as trends interacted with those initial conditions. Right. So it turns out that this is what Lasso does here mechanically is actually similar to the critique that Foote, like there's a paper, an important critique of Donohue and Levitt by Foote and Götz that where they constructed an additional regressors using which the results become statistically insignificant. So here, but so they went out and got an external data set. They merged it with this new data set and so on. So here, but just looking internally within the original data set, we can make the results insignificant. So by just flexibly controlling for state-specific trends, results seem to disappear. So this is sort of a negative result, unlike the previous example. Yes.
But all of these estimates could be biased.
Yes.
Because with the fixed, effectively linear of the abortion rate is alpha. So the impact of changing abortion in a crime-ridden state like this.
Okay.
And in a way, by forcing linearity on fixity on that coefficient, one can guarantee both the rejection and also that none of the numbers may be correct.
None of these.
Yeah. Things. Yeah. Don't we? We don't analyze misspecification here. Just. So we did reanalysis of some other examples. I guess macro example. There's Bartoli results on convergence hypothesis in the cross-country growth rates. They do hold up with our reanalysis. Recent paper by Akemoglu claiming that democracy does cause growth. We try to find the opposite, but the results hold up and stuff like this. So it's anyway. So it's so the double selection procedure. It's more robust, but it will not always produce this negative counter examples. Like in the first example, it was actually producing tighter standard errors than the original study. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about theory. So now I would like to talk about this high-dimensional model selection, and I would like to dive into theory a little bit. So to do inference in the setup that I described, we have to solve some auxiliary prediction problems quite well. So consider the following generic prediction problem, where we have the outcome variable ui. So in the context of double selection procedure, ui could be the outcome, it could be the treatment, or it could be the instrument. And we're trying to figure out good predictors among the xij's of all of these variables, right? So we have ui, we have a sum of xij's times pij's. Pij's are regression coefficients here, plus noise. The dimension here could be small, which is the traditional classical setup. Could be proportional to the sample size, or it could even be much larger than the sample size. You'll see from the rate results that it can actually, p could be much larger than the sample size. Of course, once you are in the settings like this, or in the settings like this, you have to make some assumptions in order to say something useful. But if you don't make any assumptions, when p is much bigger than n, well, there's no hope. So one assumption that we do rely on is called approximate sparsity. And the approximate sparsity captures the idea that not all of these predictors are important, and most of the regression function here could be explained by just relatively few predictors. So once you control for a few predictors here, the what's left over is not so large. Okay, so formally this could be formulated as follows. So let's consider taking the absolute values of these regression coefficients here and sorting them in decreasing order. Okay. And what we need is that after sorting, these coefficients decay fast enough. So if we look at the j's largest absolute value, denoted by this, so this subscript j with brackets, so the j's largest absolute value, this has to be less than or equal to some constant times j into the power of minus a, where a is another constant. And this is the speed of decay of the coefficients. And in order, like for our inference results, we would need the speed of decay to be bigger than one. So basically, so you take you look at these regression coefficients, you sort them in a decreasing order, and they smoothly decay to zero. Okay. So so it doesn't say so for example, none of the regression coefficients here actually have to be equal to zero. It's just that they have to decay towards zero, okay? So it doesn't impose the exact sparsity assumption. The exact sparsity assumption is where you have a small number of non-zero regression coefficients and the rest are somehow zero by some miracle. So here, none of the regression coefficients are zero. It's just that they follow a smooth decaying pattern. Right. So this generalizes the traditional assumption from the series estimation literature, or sieve estimation literature, which does rely on assumption like this, but in a much stronger form. So here we say, after sorting, the absolute values of coefficients decay like this. In series estimation literature, it's without sorting, they decay like this, the assumption. So this is a lot more general than the traditional series or sieve estimation, right? Because this allows for some high-order terms to have large coefficients, okay? So this does cover a traditional framework that we are used to. There are some other technical assumptions made on the correlation of the regressors. The assumptions are more technical in nature. They're actually not strictly needed. And I will not be discussing those assumptions. So there's one sufficient condition that's called restricted isometry, which says small groups of predictors are not close to being collinear. That's actually a very strong sufficient condition. The actual true condition is much weaker than this.
Can you translate those in terms of principal components with isometry, possibly the sparsity? Does it mean that, for instance, the first eigenvalue would be by far the largest, the rest become go to zero real fast?
I cannot. Oh yeah, the largest. Yeah, I don't want to say on the. Okay, so I don't want to spend too much time discussing this assumption because it's clearly like for example, I could have very simple violations of this assumption. So for example, I could have two perfectly collinear regressors, like two, like one regressor could be a copy of another regressor, and everything will work fine. It just doesn't matter, right? So it's clearly a strong sufficient condition. But I don't want to spend too much time on this. So the approximate sparsity, given that p is much larger than n, the approximate sparsity gives us some hope that we could say something useful about prediction in this context. And the approximate sparsity says there are several predictors here that are quite important. The rest are less important. And the model selection techniques that somehow impose sparsity or rely on this approximate sparsity assumption, one would be the classical, which is the Akaike-Schwarz type idea, and another would be the lasso type idea. So let me start out with the classical idea. Like, we minimize the sum of squared errors. You have the generic outcome. This is your prediction. This is the squared prediction error. So the sum of squared prediction errors, plus you penalize the size of the model. And so here, the size of the model is literally the sum of the non-zero, like the number of non-zero coefficients. So the indicator of Bj is not equal to zero here, right? So this is size of the model, number of non-zero coefficients. On the paper, this is a very nice procedure. Computationally or practically, it's a computationally prohibitive because this is highly non-convex function. If you try to minimize this function, you have to do combinatorial search. That's computationally prohibitive. Formally, it's like an NP hard. And so this estimate, this model selection device exists on the paper. It's a super nice model selection device. People only use this model selection device in very limited context. What Lasso does, it replaces this non-convex penalty by the closest convex penalty. Arguably, the closest convex penalty to the indicator function is the sum of the absolute values here, like the absolute values of BJs here. So you have sum of squared errors as before, and then you have plus lambda. Lambda is the penalty level here, and this is the sum of the absolute values of the coefficients. So this is, you can think of that as a convex relaxation of this ideal minimization problem. And what happens here, this is this penalty function here, it has a kink at zero. And with a large enough penalty level, for example, like this, what this would do, it would force the solution of this optimization problem to have many, many zeros, because the kink overwhelms the behavior. Like when the solution is when the gradient of this is close to zero, if lambda is big enough, then this kink in the derivative of this objective. The kink in this objective function forces lots of zeros. If you look at the first order conditions, you'll see that they're going to be the Karsh-Kuntakeres conditions. They're going to be forcing a lot of zeros in the solution. So for this reason, this objective, this lasso, the lasso technique acts as a model selection device. It forces lots of zeros, right? Sometimes people use lasso as an estimator. We'll mainly use lasso as the model selection device. Most often people do use it as a model selection device, not as an estimator.
For the lambda parameter, we usually do cross-validation to find the good lambda. What's the lambda you've written in the slide?
It's a theoretical.
It's proved to be optimal.
Yes, it's proved to be rate optimal. Nobody proved the cross-validation.
You don't use cross-validation to find the lambda parameter?
Yeah, so as far as I know, there's no result that says cross-validation works for lasso in a high-dimensional regime. There are some results in lower dimension.
Just tune the lambda parameter.
Yeah. Cross-validation is not theoretically justified yet. I mean, it works in practice, but nobody proved that it actually works. I would love to prove it, but yeah. Well, this is one theoretical rule that works. So lambda, so it's equal to the level of noise times these numbers here. This is a rule that is not very practical because it depends on the unknown level of noise. So you could use some upper bounds on this noise and iterate maybe. So formally we justify the procedure like this in Bernoulli paper. We have another version. If you like to be practical, here's a practical version of, we have the procedure called root lasso. So what you do, to take the square root of this. You keep the convexity because this is this is a norm-like object. It's convex. And it turns out with this simple modification, with the root modification, you can pick the lambda to be independent of the noise level. And so it's kind of a self-tuned estimator. So it's a Ruth Lasso. We published like biometric and the Annals of Statistics paper on this.
Can we use the same strategy for
classes when you have two numbers? No. As far as I know. Because ElasticNet also has a rich the rich part and the rich I don't know how to get rich. I mean, the optimal choice of penalty level for rich depends on the size of the coefficients. Maybe there is a way, but yeah, it's an open problem. Anyways, so this is okay, so what are the theoretical properties of Lasso? Or so this is this practical version that we sometimes use. So the Lasso as an estimator is a good estimator. It'll get you good rates of convergence. I'll mention those rates. What we're interested in here, is the quality of the model selection that the Lasso provides. Okay, so I'm only interested in the quality of the model selection, and the claim here is that it does provide high quality model selection. So under the approximate sparsity, and some other regularity conditions, these Lasso techniques, like say Lasso and Ruth Lasso, they do find parsimonious models of approximately optimal size. So the approximately optimal size here is going to be s equal to n to the power of 1 over 2a. A is the speed of decay of coefficients. Right? So this is approximately the right number of terms to keep in the model. And then if you go ahead and re-estimate those models using OLS, that's going to be called post-Lasso, like refitting. OLS refitting after Lasso selection is called the OLS after Lasso, or OLS post Lasso. The OLS will approximate the regression function, this regression function, at nearly optimal rate, which is going to be square root s over n times log p n. So s here is the effective dimension of the model. So the effective dimension shows up as square as s here. So you have square root s over n. And the overall dimension of the model here shows up only through the log term, which is good, right? Because if you have log p here, that's good, right? And so we will have consistency here as long as, so for example, p could be actually much larger than n as long as this term is converging to zero. Right, so we could have p equal to n, for example, or p equal to n into some power, and this term could still go to zero, and we'll be fine. Right, so the good news about this result is that the p shows up only through the log term. And by the way, this is also the rate at which the Lasso approximates the regression function. So this is the fact that Lasso approximates a regression function at this rate was shown by Bickel, Ritev, and Sebakov. The fact that OLS after Lasso approximates at this rate, we showed it in some papers, in the Bernoulli paper, 2013. Okay, so these are the theoretical properties of the prediction. So Lasso does provide high-quality model selection. Using those models, you can do high-quality prediction. Okay. So now we take this Lasso model selection to our inference problem. Consider the exogenous version. We have the outcome equation y equal to di times alpha plus the controls plus the noise. So we're interested in alpha here. So we go back to our inference problem, the inference about alpha. We also have to specify the relationship between this the treatment variable and the rest of the controls. It's going to be this relations. And the number of controls here could be small, could be proportional to the sample size or even larger than the sample size, as long as, well, I guess these terms are small. We do impose approximate sparsity here and here. So this, after sorting, the betas and the gammas, the regression coefficients here, they have to decay fast enough in both of these equations. So this relation has to be approximately sparse. This relation has to be approximately sparse. And then we end up using Lasso as a model selection device in these two equations. So here's how post-double selection procedure works in this high-dimensional settings. Now it's a review at this point, right? So we're going to include the predictors that are significant for predicting outcome as judged by Lasso in these high-dimensional settings, or other high-quality selection procedures. So root Lasso was another one that I mentioned. There is also Danzig selector, and there are a few other procedures that can be used. Then there's another round of selection where we say include all the XIJs that also happen to be significant predictors of outcome as judged by Lasso or other high-quality selection procedure. Then in step three, we refit the model by least squares after selection, use standard confidence intervals for inference. Okay. So this is the procedure that we've seen. Now I'm gonna mention another procedure which is gonna kind of connect to this second part of my talk. I'll say, well, there's actually a closely related procedure to this, and it's related to this partialing out that I mentioned already. So here's a version of this procedure that is gonna be first order equivalent to this. So it's gonna be work approximately the same, but it hopefully provides another angle to for better understanding what's going on here. So imagine that in step one, we do so-called partialing out. So we partial out from the outcome the effect of all the XIJs that are significant predictors of this outcome as judged by Lasso. Here we obtain this residual Y tilde. Then in step two, we partial out from DI the effect of all the XIJs that are significant predictors of this DI as judged by Lasso, obtain the residual DI. So you residualize the outcome in the treatment, and then you regress one residual on the other one using least squares in the last step and use standard confidence intervals for inference. So it turns out that these two procedures are first order equivalent. In fact, this is how the proofs actually work. And so here's the result. Uniformly within a class of approximately sparse models that obey the conditions that I stated, as well as some other technical conditions, the post-double selection estimator minus the target scaled by root n, scaled by sigma n inverse, where sigma n squared is the conventional variance formula for least squares. This is approximately normal with a mean zero and variance one. And moreover, under homoscedasticity, this estimator of alpha naught is semi-parametrically efficient. So there's not a better way to estimate alpha naught, at least under homoscedasticity. So this is the formal result. Okay, so this is a formal result, but what about Monte Carlo, right? What about Monte Carlo? Like, it's nice to have theory, but it's also nice to verify. So let's talk about this Monte Carlo experiment, where, so before we had p equal to 1. Now we'll make p equal to 200. N is going to be equal to 100. So p will be bigger than the sample size here. Things are going to be normal. We have two regression equations. The betas and the gammas will be approximately sparse. Here they will be having a quadratic decay, speed of decay. And so this sign here stands for proportionality, and the constant in front here, so this means beta j is proportional to 1 over j squared. The constant in front here is picked to have the r squared of 0.5 in each of these equations. It's like 50-50, right? So this is just to produce one picture. In the papers, we produced many, many, many pictures for different configurations, but here I'll just stick with one. Regressors are drawn from correlated Gaussian. And here are the results. So this is the the blue histogram here is the finite sample distribution of the post-double selection estimator. And the Gaussian curve here is the red one. The estimator is centered around the truth. The shape of the distribution is approximately Gaussian. It does have a small bias, but the bias is small, and it's asymptotically negligible. And so this is our theorem says that this this is kind of a graphical verification of this theorem. The theorem says that this estimator is approximately Gaussian and correctly centered. This is what we verify numerically. Right? Yeah. This is how this works indeed. So this is the double selection procedure, and we could ask a question. So what happens to the post-single selection procedure here? So it wasn't working with p equal to 1. It would be surprised that it started to work with p equal to 200. Right? It would be a surprise. Why would this be a surprise? Well, in this model, there are always betas and gammas that are close to 0. So there are always betas here that are close to 0. Right? So there are always betas that are local to 0, and we will always be making model selection mistakes here. So there's no hope that the post-single selection procedure will work in models like this. And this is a reasonable model, right? This is not, there's nothing crazy about this specification. So let's see how it works. So it wasn't working before, and it continues not to work. Right? So we see that the estimator is badly biased. The finite sample distribution of this estimator is very far away from a Gaussian distribution that we could hope to obtain under perfect model selection story. Okay. Okay. All right. So let me preview. I'm moving towards the conclusion. Let me have a couple of slides on generalization. The question is, can we generalize this machinery that I described from linear models to nonlinear? And the answer is yes. So here the inference strategy will be like this. So we're going to be interested in some structural parameter alpha, like treatment effect or regression coefficient. It could be some other number, like, I don't know, elasticity of demand, something like this. We will be using lasso or other machine learning methods to estimate the so-called reduced forms or nuisance parameters, and we'll be interested in getting good estimates of alpha. And the question is, how can we do this? So in this linear in the linear context and in the context of using lasso, I described one way to do it. More generally, the strategy would be to set up moment conditions for the structural that identify the structural parameters given the reduced form parameters. So these moment conditions will be given by the score functions that will depend on the data vector on the structural parameter reduced form. And we will argue that these moment conditions need to have this orthogonality structure with respect to the nuisance parameter. So if you perturb these nuisance parameters, if you deviate a little bit from the truth, and in practice you would, because you would have to estimate this and plug in the estimates instead of the truth and the empirical analog of these equations to back out the structural parameters. What we need is that this derivative vanishes. We will call this Niemann orthogonality property. And I will argue that this is going to be the key that generalizes what I've described. In fact, the double selection procedure that I described, or double partialing out procedure that I described, actually implicitly builds moment conditions that have this structure. And I'll argue that this is the case in the second part of my talk, where I will mention not only lasso but also other machine learning techniques for fitting the reduced form parameters. And the graphical summary of today's presentation is that if you do this proper setting up of the moment conditions, you will get the appropriate orthogonalization. So with orthogonalization or double selection in the linear context, you will get correct inference. Without orthogonalization, you will get incorrect inference. Okay, so let me conclude. So we have given the availability of rich data, we're forced to deal with model selection issues. There's a naive way to do it, which is a post-signal selection procedure. It was used conventionally quite a bit in empirical work, and I argued that it's not a good way to do it. I'm actually not the first to argue. I mean, many people have made this point before, the negative point. It was made before. There's no originality there. But we did introduce this double selection technique that offers a more constructive suggestion, right? So it's easy to be negative. It's harder to be positive. The double selection procedure was a positive suggestion here. And I'm going to argue in the second part of my presentation that the key would be to create the orthogonalized moment conditions for inference, and I'll explain more details about this construction in the second part of the lecture after the break. Thank you.
We have 5 minutes for Q&A. Is there any question. Do
the proof procedures depend on the data generation process, the true one, to be included in the big regression?
So in the follow-up paper that appeared in the Annual Review of Economics, we only rely on the formulation that I gave. Only exploits the projection formulation. It doesn't exploit the conditional expectation of epsilon given z and x equal to zero. It says that the epsilon is uncorrelated with z and x. So the results do go through under much weaker assumptions than I gave here. So there is some hope for robustness to misspecification, but there are quite a few assumptions that we make to make the results true. For example, this approximate sparsity assumption, it needs to hold for this projection equations,
right,
or regression equations.
Right.
Without it, the results break apart. We do document the breakdown of the procedure for non-sparse models. So an example of a non-sparse model would be a model where the coefficients don't die off. Like maybe they kind of bounce around. So imagine just lots of small coefficients that don't that die off very slowly.
Yeah.
We do document the breakdown of the double selection procedure there. It's in the supplementary material for this Review of Economic Studies paper. In those models, it's hard to. But those models are hopeless. There's nothing that can save.
I did a little bit of legwork for you. I earlier talked about projections and pseudo-true values.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some familiarity with
it. Yes, yeah.